Okay, let's go ahead and get ourselves going for today. Welcome to session 10 of CEE 120B 220B. Our intent today is really to spend a lot of our time talking about structural systems and some of the nuances of modeling structural systems. So what I want to try and do is actually demonstrate some of the principles we talked about in terms of grids and laying out the basic structural framework on some of your buildings, but also take a look at some buildings that are a little more unusually shaped. Okay, and how we might go ahead and approach them creatively. So, yeah, it's really all about just kind of answering questions. I think what I'll do, we've asked Jacqueline to share her model as well as Seng Chai. Let me start with Jacqueline's first, in that it's a very regular form. It's kind of a much more rectangular sort of arrangement. We can think about your structure and kind of some of the tricks we can play with in there, as well as you had a question about ramps or bridges or things like that.
Okay. I think the only irregular thing is the oval shape in the middle.
Okay.
So like, have to put like steel.
Let's go ahead and talk about it. So again, what we're getting to is really doing structural modeling. What I'll do is set up a linked model. Okay, so I have your architectural model. I'll go for that, and then we'll talk about modeling the different structural elements. And as we think about modeling the structural elements in specific, I'll pay attention to the gravity elements. We'll think about both the planes, the floors and roofs, you probably have a pretty good sense of how you're doing those. They're going to be supported by a series of beams and beam systems. Circular openings in particular are kind of a funny issue. How do you go through and do something like that? And we'll show you how you kind of approximate it, starting with a rectangular grid and moving on from there. And we'll look at this whole issue of the vertical supports in terms of the columns, whether we're supporting from below with columns or walls, or whether we want to think about, you know, kind of carrying the loads with cantilevers or even hanging the load, something like that. It's a lot of kind of cool strategies for doing something like this. When we get up to roofs, we're going to start thinking about beams to support the roof. And in particular, sometimes on roofs we have sloping beams or sloping joists that are supporting the roof. I think that when we get to your building, Seng Chai, we'll have some of that to kind of work with. So we'll kind of take a look at how that sort of works too. So it's just really, today is really more than anything kind of a catch-up day, just trying to think about how structures apply. So please, more than ever today, just really interrupt, ask questions, and really kind of, yeah, get into the problems that you're specifically thinking you may have in your buildings. Like Henry, I know you have some cantilevers, we have some funny overhangs that are second floor shading first floors. There'll be some specific issues like that. Okay, so let's see if we can kind of make this relevant to you guys. So I'll go over to Revit right now, and in Revit, I think we're going to start by opening Jacqueline's structure. So let's do that. Where did Revit go? It's over here somewhere. Close up my little sun guy here. Okay, I got too many things open. Okay, so now Jacqueline, you've given us the architectural model? Okay, very good. What I'm going to do is I'm going to start by opening the structural template. I'll start building the structure there, but we can still go back and remind me when we get to the bridge part, because I'll start with this, the whole issue of the opening and how we go from there. Okay, I'm in the structural template. I am ready to start creating. What I will tend to do is as follows. I'll start by inserting, and I'll insert a link to your architectural file. Again, always trying for origin to origin. That's going to be the strongest relationship to kind of keep everything aligned to each other. And when I go on out to that thumb drive, let's see if I can find that thumb drive. USB drive there. Where did you put it? Is it down?
It's in Draft 3.
There's, where is it? Draft 3?
Yeah, I didn't rename
it. What a descriptive name! I'm very, very bad about that. Okay, so let's see what we got going on here. Let me zoom to fit. You'll see as a starting point, not everything's showing up, and that's very common because by default in the structural view, the structural framing plans are set up with this designation right here. It says discipline structural, and that's the part we often need to change. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to keep the plain old level 2 structural, but I'm actually going to duplicate that view. Okay, so I could have a separate view where I can see things together. I'll duplicate that view. I get the choice of with detailing or not. In this case, I'll do it without the detailing. If I had a lot of dimension lines or tags in there or notes, I might want to include the detailing. I'll just say duplicate it. And I'm going to rename it. Renaming won't really do anything proper. It's just going to go through and give us something to work with. I'll call this my coordination view. And again, the reason I'm creating a coordination view is just often it's not helpful to pop back and forth between the structural and the mixed architectural one, just so I can kind of keep track of my work. So I'll change that over to coordination. A lot of things will probably show up now. In particular, I'm probably going to see the basic walls. Notice I don't see curtain walls, okay, though we can turn those on. In particular, there's this designation about structural walls versus regular walls, okay, just plain old architectural walls. And in general, you want to copy structural walls over. But let me just, for the purpose of this view, just say visibility graphics. And I'll just turn on those curtain systems and curtain panels, and even the mullions, just so I can see them in the background there. So it sort of completes the image. Okay, so I got my level 2 coordination view. This is actually looking pretty good. Before I go very far though in terms of placing things, what I really want to do is get any grids and any levels that are set up to kind of be copied into here. Now, as I look at it, it looks like there are no grids yet. Is that true? Okay, great, so we'll put in some grids. On the level side, let's do this. Let's go over to like any of the elevations, it doesn't matter which one. South is as good as any. I'm gonna come zooming on here. You can see we have some different levels set up, basement 1, basement 2, level 3. Okay, as well as level 1 and level 2 in there. You'll see what's actually happening is in the structural file, there's two levels by default, at 0 and at 10 feet. And what we want to do is copy your levels in so that when I say level 1 to level 2, I'm getting the same coordinates, okay, I'm getting the same dimensions. To do this, it all starts with this notion of doing something called copy monitoring, and that's under the Collaborate tab. I'll say copy monitor from a linked project, so I'll select a linked project, which is just going to be, it's almost easiest to see, it's the big blue box, but let me see if I can zoom out again. I'm in the middle of something, so it's not going to want me to do it. There's the linked project right there. Okay, so now I am ready to, actually, did I get it? Try it again. Copy monitor from a selected link project. I'll see if I can select the link. There it is. Okay, notice I've been thrown into a funny mode right now. And this is actually one of the confusing things about copy monitor. You're in this weird mode, and if you don't do it in precisely the right order, it doesn't finish what you wanted to do. We're gonna choose some elements to copy using the copy tool, and when we get done, we have to say finish, okay? That'll say, okay, I wanna keep all those changes that I just made. So what I'm gonna do is go through and copy. I'm gonna start by copying, level 1. Now, this seems kind of anticlimactic because level 1 is at level 1, they're a match, but this will make sure that if anything changes, they stay in sync with each other. I'll go out and grab level 2. That'll move my structural level 2 to match the architectural level 2. Super. Looks like that's, looks like I have a roof level in here too, so let me grab that too. Now, for level 3, what's going to happen is, since there isn't a level 3, okay, it's going to go through and create a new level 3 in the structural file, okay, to match it. Now, it's created a level 3, or it's creating a level 3 right now. Notice, however, it's not quite giving you everything you want because over here it doesn't say level 3. And that's okay, it's created the level, it exists, we just have to later go back and tell it to put in floor plans to match those levels. Okay, let's go ahead and get the basement levels too, since they're kind of hanging around also. So, what do I have here? If I go panning around, see if I can pan this. So I'm also going to go through and grab my, go back to copy monitor again there, copy my basement 1 and my basement 2. Okay, so again, the reason doing this, I just want my structure to match those other levels, and if you ever do change those other levels, the structure will stretch and kind of adapt those things. So, super, I got them. I'm going to go through and say finish. I have to say finish, otherwise we'll lose that work. So now what happens, although it's a little hard to see, we actually have 5 different levels. If I go over to like the north elevation, maybe we'll be able to confirm that. So. You can see over here, I got a bunch of different levels. I think all five are here. But let's go ahead and change it so we can also see those over here in the list of structural plans. You probably want to have some structural plans as well as some coordination views. So let me, can I show you how we do this? What we do is we come up and we, under the View tab, if we want to create some additional plan views, we choose plan views. And I can say whether I want to be a structural plan, which is, again, biased towards having the structural discipline versus a floor plan. Okay. So I want to get some structural plans. Notice that here, it's only giving me the new levels, because there's this checkbox turned out right here that says, do not duplicate the existing levels. So if that's on, you won't get them all. If that's off, you'll get them all. It's just to kind of help you not duplicate. I'll say let's choose those three. And notice what happens is now in the structural plan section, okay, it's actually showing as, you know, all the different structural levels are sort of floating around in there. Okay, so we'll have all the floor levels we need. Let me go ahead and, in the same sense, maybe it would actually be even better, rather than creating the level 3-2 coordination as a structural plan, if I just created a floor plan. Okay, so what I can do is under plan views, say floor plan. Again, not a whole lot different in here, but let's go through and choose all those. See, they'll show up in a slightly different section of the tree. A different, slightly different set of attributes associated with those. Now, for the floor plan views, we'll want to check. Right now, it still has the discipline structural, so a really nice thing you can do is actually choose several different views. We don't think about doing this too often, but views have properties the same as everyone else. So if you choose a bunch of them, you can say, let's make them coordination. So it'll start showing a little more information in there. Now, we don't often talk about this notion. There's actually something called a view template, which is a way of copying settings between different views and making them common. For example, in these five different views, I might want to show the curtain walls, the curtain wall mullions, all those things. So I can say VG. Actually, can I do that for all of them? Let's see if I can, if it does it for the common thing. It may not. Let me try that again. I think it's thinking. I don't think I can do it for all of them. So let me do it the other way, which is to go to one of the levels and say visibility graphics there, VG. Oh, come on, you. Stop doing that, VG. Okay, now you got me wondering. View visibility graphics. I will turn on the curtain walls and whatever I want to show there. Now here's the rub. I got all these things, they're hanging around in that basement view right now. If I would really like the same set of visibility settings to apply to all of the different views or to a whole subset of the views, this is where view templates could become very handy. Think of view templates as being a set of settings that you want to apply like a macro. A whole bunch of things just so they're all uniform. So what I can do is actually for basement one, if I have these settings being the way I like, I can say view templates, let's create. And why is it not doing that? Why is that blanked out right now? It says none. I'm gonna pop that over there again. Here we are. View templates. I'm going to create a template for the current view. I'm going to call this, is going to be my architectural coordination views. Okay, and it actually gives me the option of choosing which things I want to adopt. Whether I want the issue of scale being something to be enforced, whether I want the visibility graphics overrides for the model or the annotation categories, how the model is displayed, how the lighting is. You can choose what you do or don't want included in this template. Which is kind of good, because then you have a lot of control. I'll just accept all of them for now. Okay, notice what's going to happen now under basement one. I can say make it follow the coordination view template, okay, which doesn't make a very big difference because it was defined on that. But if I go up to like level one, or any of these, I can say, let's go ahead and choose them and basically apply that view template say okay. Now, there's kind of even an interesting but very subtle choice you have here. If you say okay, it'll apply the template and then those settings are essentially locked on that view. Okay? If you say apply the properties, it'll apply the current settings, but they won't be locked and it's only for now. So if you change the settings in the template later, they won't update. So you either decide whether you want a hard relationship or not. And I'll just let it be a hard relationship. Super. So now, theoretically, in all these different views, we should have all the same sorts of things showing up. Okay, great. Now, we don't have a 3D view which has those things. If I want to also have a 3D view, which is very handy, I'll create a default 3D view. Here it is. Again, this is just currently set up as a coordination view or as a structural view. So what you're actually seeing is you're seeing the floors. You'd see any walls which are considered structural, okay, and sort of the holes in the floors. If I want to go through and create this as, I'll duplicate this. I'll rename that as 3D coordination. Then I can go through and again change the discipline, or if I try, I should be able to apply the same template. Actually, it's interesting. It's for a plan view or not. Let me try this. I'll do all of them. Okay, so now we have that building hanging around in there. We can later on decide that we want to make the walls transparent or something like that. In fact, that's a very good thing to do. Let me try this just because it's sort of, again, just helpful as you're working. Do you ever notice that you have that issue where you have to keep on turning things off and turning them on and turning them off and turning them on so you can see inside of things? And if that sounds like you, what you can do is, let me go ahead and turn this template back off. Okay. What I'm going to do is for this individual view, just change the visibility graphics. And what I can do is actually go through and change the transparency of things. So let me try this. I'm going to say all, see if I can get this. I can get them all at the same time or not. I'll say walls and give them a transparency of like 80%. Let's see if this will work. Oh, it did apply to all of them. Excellent. Okay. The reason I'm doing that is I want them to be there, but I want to be able to see through them. Okay. So that just gives you the ability to, kind of be able to kind of see through, but still be able to see things. So again, that could be useful to you. But again, everything I've done so far has really just been, I'm just messing around in the view, trying to set myself up with some good, helpful views to work with, just to make my life easier. I haven't done any modeling. I'm just sort of setting it up, and now I have these link things set up. So great. I'm going to save this as, and I'll just put it out on my desktop for now. This is a Jacqueline structure. Beautiful. So let's go ahead and put some structure into this thing. I'm going to go off to, let's do it on level one. As good as anything. As you think, that's the structural plans. Let me do the coordination view. It might be a little bit easier to see. Okay. So as you're thinking about this, I don't know, can you spot any good grid lines in here? I can spot a couple that might make reasonable grid lines. As you think about this, where are you planning on putting your grid lines?
lines, vertical grid lines.
Okay, and did you, for up to down, how many did you go there? Five? Yeah, excellent. So let's just try it. I am going to just bet.
Actually, I forgot about the scale.
What's that?
I forgot about the scale. I'll probably need another one in the middle.
Well, no worries. Okay, let's just start with that one. Okay, and which what do you call that direction? Is that a, is that going to be the ABC direction, or is that the 1, 2, 3 direction?
ABC.
That'll be the ABC direction?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, great. So I'll just go through and change that. Okay, zoom to fit. Okay, notice I'm at 8th scale. At 8th scale, for this large a building, things are very small. I might want to change that just to a higher scale, like 16th or something like that, or even 1/32nd, because just at the scale of your building. The annotations are very small. So I'll go through, and you're going to place those precisely based on whatever relationship you want to have the outer skin with the inner skin. I'm betting that you sort of came up with some sort of grid line around here. And probably one around. Okay. Then we'll put some on the other side. Although you're suggesting now, and I think it's probably a good idea, to have one that's just going to right in the center. Okay. Didn't do a very good job of that one in terms of I shifted it down a little bit. Actually, let me kind of show you another way to do this that sort of works well. If you go to grid, and you just say offset, I'll just put them in there and I'll drag them over. But this will make them all sort of show up at the same place. Like there's 30 feet. Okay, since I'd already created a D, that's why it skipped that one. I should go back and fix that. But now I can go drag that over. I'll drag that one over. More or less. Great. I still got you backwards, or E moved. Okay, let's go ahead and do it in the other direction too. I'll do some grid lines over here. Again, sort of starting back over here. I'll say that's one. But how many do you have in this direction, would you guess?
Eight.
Eight? I think that might be reasonable. I'm just going to offset them kind of a big distance first, and then we'll go back and adjust their locations. Oops, I got a ninth one in there. Okay. But I'm betting you're doing something like this down here. Then, what do you think that next line is? Is it kind of right around here on the edge of the atrium?
Yeah, maybe.
Okay. Maybe down here? I don't know. There's always, you know, just, it's always a matter of just sort of, you know, almost like guesstimating. Maybe I'll put that at the center of the atrium right there. Okay, so if you told me those were your grids, I'd say that looks perfectly plausible in terms of there's some sort of scale to the whole things. Again, 20 by 20, 30 by 30, even 40 by 40 is kind of okay. If it's getting much bigger than that, chances are the beams are getting really, really big. So we'll think about trusses or heavy duty things that might have to replace those, but that's perfectly plausible. So within that, if you once you have those grids in there, we typically go through and again start with the columns. I almost always start with the columns, where I'll say under structure. And how are you building? Are you building in a steel or what are you building out of?
Steel.
Excellent. So I'll say some columns. I will choose a little about the columns. Now for the columns, I'm not going to worry too much about the size because the structural analysis program is going to help me figure out the size. I can, based on my experience and wisdom of having done this many times before, sort of guesstimate the size. But ultimately, analysis and optimization will tell us what they really need to be. But I'll just sort of choose, oh, maybe 12 by 40. As I'm choosing these, really the important thing I'm doing is just allowing space for them in the design. Ultimately, they will be sized appropriately. But for most designs, whether it's 12 or 14, it's not going to make a very big difference in terms of spatial. It's really more just how they need to be architecture or for the structural requirements. I'll say, oh, let's place these on the grids. As you think about placing them on the grids, which is sort of a really nice way to do it, you can actually do something very quick if you like. You want to ultimately choose all the grid lines. Watch this. If you choose from the lower right to the upper left, you'll get all the grid lines in both directions and have the intersections. And you can say, let's go ahead and finish. Oops. Before I do that, I should be careful. I'm always kind of zipping on in and being a little bit not cautious enough. I have the choice of height versus depth. If I'm on level one right now, I'm gonna go up to level two. I just wanna check that. Otherwise, they might be going down to the basement level. So once again, I'll say columns. I'll put them at the height, put the at, not at columns, cancel that. The at columns choice would be if you already put architectural columns in there. I'm gonna put on grids. Go zipping on through and say, let's go ahead and finish them. So super, it's put a whole bunch in here. Let's go back and take a look. For looking at this, I'll look at sort of the 3D structural model as opposed to the coordination model. Okay, so I got a whole bunch of columns in there at the first floor level. Now, as we think about that big atrium in terms of what's going on here, let's talk about this in terms of how you either want to sort of do a circular opening or you want to sort of cut that hole around the atrium. Either way, because they're both sort of interesting issues. So let's just look at that as we start placing the beams. Actually, even for the beams, let me show you a quickie way to sort of do that.
I was thinking that it would be like two pretty separate structural systems mm-hmm. for the oval shape.
Okay, so the big circle around it is one system, and the middle system is almost a separate system in the middle. Okay, excellent. That could work. Henry, question?
Is that modeling, is that just the shaft?
Oh, in terms of that, it could be done as a shaft. In this case, did you cut the holes in the floors, or did you cut it as a shaft? Well, actually, let's talk about this. It probably, in this case, would make sense to do holes in the floors, because the shaft would actually cut out, we couldn't put a floor in the middle again. Because it would cut out, like...
Unless you have an offset for the shaft.
Yeah. Well, so this is one where I would actually do it as a series of floors. Holes in the floors.
Oh, holes in the
floor. I think. Even they may offset a little bit from floor level to floor level. So I'd probably go that way. But it's a good question. Okay, let's do this. I'm going to put some structural beams in here. Again, I want to show you just kind of quickie ways of doing things. So watch this. If you go to, I could do this in, let me do it in a level two plan. Okay, what I want to do is put some beams in there. Again, I'm doing this just really quick so we have a starting point, but then we'll go through and refine it. I can say I want to put those 12 by 26s, that's fine, or some other size if I think they need to be a little bit bigger. Make the 14 by 30s. Okay, the placement plane is very critical. This is gonna be at what level they're gonna be placed. So I'm gonna put these at level two. Okay, that's super. 3D snapping would be important if I'm doing it in 3D. Okay, but this is the thing of, if we think about the steel and the height of the top of the steel relative to the floor slab, if I wanna put that little offset to kind of make sure it goes below the deck, this is as good a time as any to put it in there. Because that'll just sort of put it in proactively in front of everything. Now, you're thinking, okay, this is sounding great. I'm going to go through and draw all the different kind of beams going from the columns to the columns and kind of connect them all together. But there's even an easy way to do it here is you can say on grids. And what tends to happen if you choose on grids here is, again, every grid line you choose will basically put a row of beams that connect the columns. Okay. So in that same funny sense, if I just go ahead and do this and get rid of the action center, I should get a whole lot of beams at level 2. Let's go ahead and finish that. Okay, not too awfully bad, but we do have some things we want to sort of fix about this. For example, right now, I'm not doing a very good job of modeling your atrium. Okay, so for your atrium, what I probably want to do is this. So I'll go through and pull out some of those beams that are going around the outside there. I'm guessing it's like this. Is it something like that? Okay, great. Let's think about just a few other issues. Okay, right now you'll see that my beams are going right up against the edge of the columns right now. We can think a little about if we would like the second floor to cantilever out a little bit and kind of have the columns sit back a little bit relative to where the edge of the floor is. Okay, and doing something like that is actually very easy. I'm going to encourage you to think about cantilevers wherever you can. The difference between, sort of, for example, cantilevering things and just having it right on the edge is that, well, it's just really, do you want the columns to be right at the edge or do you want them to be offset and set back a little bit? So if you're thinking about doing cantilevers, not to worry. All you have to do is go ahead and pull some of these out a little bit and kind of choose some distance that feels reasonable. Okay, so I have some sort of beam. It's cantilevered out there right now. And now I can actually start joining things together. I can go through and kind of put some beams in the other direction too. But let me go ahead and kind of do it over on this side here. So, for example, I could go ahead and pull this out. Notice when I do pull that out, it has sort of a funny property that goes with it over here. Let's see if I could find it. Start, stop, where is it? Top, end level offset. I'm looking for the justification of it. I'm not seeing that right now. Let me try it over here. End join cutback. I want to think about a way to do this uniformly. I should actually do this in 2D to be a little bit better. I'm moving the beam right now. That's not what I have in mind. Pull that out. Okay. What I can do now is actually join the ends of those with something that we call a spandrel. It'd be something that would just support the edge of the floor, but be supported as cantilevered beams. And to do that, I can sort of say, let's go ahead and take a beam, snap it by 3D, and just snap from here to here, and have a little bit of an overhanging kind of balcony right now. Okay, so it's okay to go through and push things out a little bit if you want to sort of extend beyond. You don't need to have columns right on the end of everything. Other sort of questions that sort of come up, I think like Gustavo, even when we were working, we sort of looked at this whole issue of, can you go through and T-beams into things as opposed to having them always come to sort of straightforward intersections? And you can. You could take a beam like this and again go from here and carry it back. Again, this is a little sloppy for me to be doing in 3D because in 3D it's a little hard to control what's going on. In 2D it'd be a little bit better. But I can go through and snap it across there and have really more of a T relationship right there, where what's happening is it's not that we're going to put a column in there. Oops, that's not good because it's going to show the floor. But we're going to basically have a beam which is hanging off the end of another beam. There's going to be some clips in there, some welding to hold it up. So you got to start thinking creatively about like how you support things and kind of bring them up, because very often that'll come very, very useful to you to not go through and always have columns right at the end. Very often we extend a little bit to kind of create different effects that we like. So let's think about some variations on this scheme relative to your building. One is, let's talk about a hole on the inside of something, and then we'll talk about a hole like doing the other, which is kind of like a round thing on the inside instead. Okay, so let me go to, for example, level 2, where these beams are located right now. And we'll just talk. You can see I didn't do a very good job of joining those, or at least they're offset a little bit, so I should clean those up in 2D. What I want to think about is, what if, just for example, Jacqueline had some sort of nice like atrium. She had either an oval atrium or a round atrium, something like that. But she wanted to go through and put some sort of like big old atrium-like opening there, and how we'd go through and frame that up. And the deal is, okay, you got that hanging around in there. You want to go through and try to approximate that as close as you can with a series of different square members, or sort of members that are relatively straight line. So if you have some sort of condition like that and you have a hole like that, the most common thing to do is to go through and let's just take some beams. Actually, I should just be very careful about there at level 2, super. I'll go through and bring one up on this side. I'll bring one up on that side. Notice I'm kind of almost in the hole right now, so I might need to move that over a little bit. Okay. I'll go through and again, we're trying to just basically support the floor plane as best we can. So I could go through and put one on this end. And I'll do the same thing on the other side. Now, if you look carefully at the screen, you'll actually see something interesting happening. As I put the additional beams in there, let's see if we can zoom in and see. Let me even turn off the thick line or the thin lines. Can you see there's actually sort of a hierarchy of line weights? These large girders, which are collecting a lot of loads, are sort of fat. These intermediate ones are kind of thin, but still solid. Now these are actually dotted lines. And it's just really helping giving you a little bit of visual feedback about the hierarchy of how it's all rolling up. So it's quite okay. In general, every time you have an opening in the floor or the opening in the roof, you frame it in like that. You do something like that just to get close to it, okay? Beyond that, you say, okay, there's still this issue of in the corners of the circle, okay, you know, how is that supported? And it really depends on how big that is and whether the floor decking itself can support that on its own. If it can, we just do it like that, because floor decking with concrete on the top can support. It doesn't have to be supported right on the edge. It has a little of ability to cantilever. But if you needed to support it further, what you would tend to do is something like this. And I'll push that on back. Come on back in there. Great. So once you have it on this side, go ahead and take care of all your, you have all sorts of drafting infrastructure that kind of comes to your advantage. Let's go ahead and just grab that guy right there. And I can say, let's go ahead and I'll draw a mirror line. I'll draw that from the center of this over to here. Hey. And then in the same sense, I will now grab this one over here and this guy over here, a little control clicking action, and draw, oh, from the center of the circle over this way. Okay, so typically if you have some big old opening, you'll approximate the edge as best you can using a series of straight line segments, getting as close as you can. And that's actually pretty reasonable, is a way to go through and approximate it. So very often, a round opening will show up looking something like this. Okay, we'll look at the inversion, which is the round structure, in just a second here. But notice as I'm drawing this, you got a couple of different things going on. I got the beams floating around. You'll also notice, can you see those little orange, green, and red lines? Okay, so what's going on over there is, those are what's considered to be the analytical model. And the analytical model is, it's the lines where the structural loads are considered to be carried. You notice they're actually floating a little bit higher because by default, it's just staying right at the floor level. Even though the steel is gonna be down 5 inches, it's gonna be kind of attached, you know, welded probably to the bottom of the deck. There'll be some sort of shear transfer studs in the deck. And, you know, we'll consider the loads as though they're being at that floor level, you know, even though they'll be carrying a little bit low, because we're gonna think of it as a lower, we're thinking of it as being sort of a single uniform structure, okay, in terms of doing that. But those analytical models are really the places where we're gonna start applying the loads through the floor or directly to the beams. You notice the beams tend to show up in orange. The beams also have a green and a red, and that's just sort of the issue of a start versus an end. And what is start versus end? It's almost kind of arbitrary. I think it has to do with the order in which you draw the ends. Okay, but in fact, when you were placing things, yeah, everything has a start and an end. Okay, so you can start to go through and think about how an opening like that works. So if you have an interior circle or even an oval, can you imagine how you would sort of like approximate it with a shape like this? I think, Gustavo, for you, you have that atrium in the middle of the building. It's a nice rectangular atrium, so you'll just have the things that support it around the edge. But think about that whole issue about whether you want to do that little bit of a cantilever to, you know, do you want the edge of the floor to be right at the columns, or do you want it to be in or out a little bit relative to those columns? Because, you know, you can make it that happen in the floor deck. Okay, so let's pause here for a second. Does this sort of make sense in terms of how a hole takes? Okay, great. Let's do the other, which is you have this oval structure in the middle, and that's kind of interesting too. So let's come over here. So I'll zoom on out. Okay, so what do you think about this oval structure here and how we're gonna go through and support it? Yeah.
Does,
yeah, like a radial array or something in there. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Or, for instance, like a polygon that goes outside and goes straight to
mm-hmm. Let's talk about that. In general, with steel, we tend to approximate curves with polygons. Concrete's kind of interesting. Concrete, you could actually make the little curve.
Yeah.
Yeah, but you know, it's a little bit harder with steel. You can curve steel. If you do curve steel, you know, your construction manager curses you because it just costs a lot of money to curve steel. It's possible, but it's a sort of an expensive operation. So think about, you know, will it be exposed? Is it important that the true curvature shows? Or is it going to be covered with some sort of surface where it won't really matter because I can curve the surface but have the steel actually be at a straight line approximation in between? Okay, so, you know, very good things to sort of think about as you get going. But for this, you know, even there I have this kind of weird column kind of hanging over there. That's probably not where it's going to be, right there. But I'll come up with some sort of a grid system. Let's think about this.
Is it better to use concrete for this center restaurant cafe thing?
Not necessarily. I think, let's think about this. If you were using steel primarily as the structural material, I think it might be better just to keep using steel just because it's very familiar. It's kind of essentially one construction technique. Like, I wouldn't go to concrete just because it's easier to model.
No, because like I was thinking of a composite, so I'll be using concrete everywhere as well. Mm-hmm. So it's not really like only for this center piece. Mm-hmm. Because I was thinking concrete may be more like a fire protection and slightly structural for mm-hmm. the steel. So all we see is probably more concrete than steel, mm-hmm. although the load-bearing thing is for the steel.
Okay, so then you could have a combination of the steel inside the concrete mm-hmm. and kind of encased in the concrete. Again, that's a valid strategy in terms of thinking about it. So, you know, I think you can go either way in terms of doing it. Let me do it as a straight line. I'll do a straight line on one side, and we'll do a kind of curved line on the other side, just to kind of illustrate. Sadly, in terms of the grids are, well, maybe I can do this. I was going to say that I'm not going to have a very easy time doing something, but maybe I can. If I do a 3-foot offset, and then what we keep on struggling with is, this is a lovely oval in here, and ovals are just sort of funny shapes. And it looks like I can actually do that. Okay, no worries. So what we're going to do is we're going to come as close as I can to approximate that, which is really just to, I'll do it as an arc. So I'll do arc here. Oh, that's sort of disappointing because it really isn't as good as I want it to be in terms of doing a grid line. That is kind of really sad. I could do this whole multi-segment thing. Let's see if I'll do anything in here. I still can't grab it. But what I could do then is, I'll do a couple different segments. I'll do here. The key thing is, if you go through and you do a series, let's try that. Then I'll do to here. And then I do to here, I can pretty well approximate it. It's not exactly, but it's pretty close. Okay, so that can be a grid line. And then we can go through and place columns on that. The other way we might do it is now, we could also do the radial thing too, in terms of this little subgrid just for this little separate section of the building. I could go ahead and do kind of like, this. And then maybe I can take that grid and do a little radial array on it. I'll say array. I'll do a radial array. I'll move the center line to over here, right at the center of the building. And then depending upon what I want, would I want like 6 of them or something like that? I'll just go from here. I think what I did was just a little goofy there. Try that again. Here, we'll say radial array. To the last one, let's say 6 of those. I'll make it to the last one, not the second one. If I did it to the last one, or the second one, what happened is it swung 180 degrees, back to 360, it went around several times. So what I'm gonna do is place the center of rotation right there, then go to the last. Okay, now I think we're good. No, opposite side, but it's the same sort of idea. Okay, so now I have these kind of hanging around here. Let me go ahead and flip them, or I'll mirror them. OK, Okay, so we can once again use the whole thing about the grid lines and the columns and all that kind of stuff. So I could say structural column at the grids. Let me go ahead and just grab these grids where I will do that one. And then, oh, it's interesting. I have to do the segments. Okay, let's go back to 3D. You'll see I have my little forest of columns hanging around in here. I can now start connecting them together. So this is, again, I'll do it just with the straight line segments first, approximating that I'm doing it with steel. So I'll say beam, come across. Level 2, 3D snapping. So I'm getting the outer edges. That's kind of okay in terms of what's going on. Right to level 2. Let us talk about how we would infill this, though. As you're thinking about trying to sort of fill this in, if we got those columns around the edge, how would you think about the interior portion of this? Would you think about doing this in a very linear way? Would you think about doing it in sort of a radial way? Yeah, because it can go either way. A radial way? I think a lot of people would approach it that way. So what they would do then is they'd say, let's go ahead and put some sort of beam in almost from here to that one. And then I'll do this one to that one. Okay, that'd be kind of okay. If it was strictly around structure, a lot of people do that, especially if there's a hole in the middle of the structure. Then you get into this whole issue of, okay, we want to go through and fill in this area with, you know, some sort of a beam system between here. And as you think about that, you can choose a beam system, and usually what ends up happening is, let me go ahead and sketch it, because it'll be hard to kind of do it automatically. I'll say that this is a boundary. Oops, that's not good. And just draw it for a second. Okay. What we would do is we would say that we've put these two different sort of wedges in there. There actually is something that comes across here. I'll put the little I-beams in here at the end. Okay, so now if we try to draw the beam system, what we want to do is we want to choose this boundary. I can choose this boundary. For that last boundary, I could choose it also or just kind of connect it, but I'll choose that one there. So the question is going to be really, how do the beams run within that system? And what will typically happen is this. When you first choose the beam system, you'll see these little parallel lines that'll show up like that. That'll be on the first side that you select. Okay, so, and this would basically mean that the beams are going like this. We're kind of following that parallel line coming on down. Which again, may or may not be what we want it to do. So what you want to do is, if you're thinking about actually going radial, is either choosing this, okay, and then it'll draw the beam system and do that, and kind of follow it that way and kind of make the pie wedge. Okay, or you can even say that you're going to draw a beam direction line. If you draw the beam direction line, and you can draw it at whatever angle sort of makes sense, all the beam system will be parallel to that line. So you got a couple choices in there. So, I don't know, just different things to think about in terms of doing that.
Is there any special thing I need to do for the center?
For the very center?
Yeah.
Nah, it's really just kind of a big, messy connection where there's a lot of funky welding and like brackets that are coming in there. It's really hard if you have like five or six different things coming in there together. So chances are they're all six aren't going to come in together. There's probably going to be like two or three that come in and other ones will sort of attach to it nearby, but they won't all come in. Either that or you just have to put some really weird kind of post in there with a lot of brackets on all sides. But actually, you will see things like that. You'll see things like that. There's some sort of like tubey thing that gets built in here where there's a bracket here and there's a bracket here. And there's a bracket here. Although, you might want to think about it the other way. If you would like to keep the center open, let's think about that. Okay. What you can do is think about putting your first beam in more like this, going all the way across, okay, and then tie these into it. Okay. So you just have a column and a column and columns at the outsides. But if you want that whole center thing to be open in the middle, think of, you know, really what's the shortest distance across, which you could span the entire thing and then put a single beam across there and then hang everything off that instead. So I think that's sort of the macro lesson of this whole lecture today. The whole notion is really to think, just start thinking creatively, because what happens so often is when we go through and we start putting all these columns in, we form these rectangular grids, we start creating this forest of columns and it just almost gets to be too many of them, where a lot of times, if that's not what you want to have architecturally, you know, you can eliminate them and just do some carrying the loads in other ways. You don't need columns everywhere. And it'll just be a little, a bit cleaner and closer to the architecture you're really trying to achieve. Okay, so let's kind of hang with that for a second. Okay, let me go back in. I'm going to open up your file again. Let's see if it works, because I want to talk about the funny cantilever on the outside, which is Henry's case, and then we'll go to Sengchai's case. Okay, so hang on. Let me go back into Revit and see if we can make this work. See how long ago it was that I saved. And it's only right that I've been stung by the same thing that I always say to you guys, like, only continue working without saving as long as you're willing to lose your work. So, if it's gonna be painful, go ahead and save. I should have saved that. Okay, so it looks like this is probably just the main structure kind of carried in, not to worry. Let's go back in again. I'll just do something real quick. On level one, I'll go to the coordination view. Okay, super. I'll go through and just draw a couple grid lines in here. Because my point for this part is pretty simple. And I'll draw these grid lines coming across here. Okay. And then I'll put these columns and beams in there again. I'll say column, structural column. Going up from a height to level two, that's super. I'll put them on the grids. Okay, that should be good, I think. Great. And now we'll go through and fill in the gap again. Level two, put some beams in there. Structure, beam, let's come on, I'll put them on the grids also. Oops, let me go ahead and give the minus 5 inches while I'm at it. Minus 5 inches, apply that, and now we'll come back in and get these. So the issue I want to address here is, besides the fact that looks funny, I've got some sort of structural system in here. What happens in some buildings, though, is that I want to go through and actually have an overhang where I have a first floor, but the second floor actually overhangs it a little bit. And that's just sort of a real common situation. I'm going to put another beam in here. So we de-snap it. Okay. So the issue is, if I wanted to go through and, for example, it almost looks like it here, I have a second floor which overhangs from the first floor a little bit and I want to support that, but I want to sort of have a shading overhang, but I don't want to put columns out there because I don't want to interrupt the fantastic row of windows out there. Okay, what I can typically do is something like this. You can even sort of see what's going on. That's the edge of the floor over there. This is the column over here, or the beam. What I'm going to do is actually just pull the beam on out. Okay, and I want to sort of pull these to some sort of uniform distance. I'm going to pull them out a little too far right now. Get them so they're even with that floor. So maybe coming on back. It'd be nice if I actually sort of put a really precise measurement on here. Okay, but I'll come back into 3D. You'll see those are now cantilevered out there. So now I can go back and go through and put the beams between them. So that's a nice little cantilevered edge, kind of like that balcony or something like that. So you might have something like that at the edge of your building where those come on out. Now, you will note that currently the hierarchy of all these steel elements isn't quite right, because even though that beam is cantilevering across it, it still looks like the columns kind of have been poking right through the whole thing and penetrating it. So, you know, analytically this is correct in terms of if we structurally analyze it, it considers that one long beam that cantilevers over, it'll compute right. It'll sort of look like it right in a lot of senses. It won't look right in terms of the actual steel detailing that goes on in there. So what we'll have to do is still go back and do a little bit of adjustment to this. You know, not analytically, but we'll go ahead and sort of start giving things different offsets and really start to think about how those beams and columns join together. And there's actually a tool that I don't use very often, beam and column joins, okay, which allows you to sort of think about how things are joining relative to each other. Okay, but I haven't played around with that much, so I'm not going to do it that way. I'll just come in here and even say that, oh, what's going on here? I could attach the column to the base of that. Let's try that. Let's try attaching the column to the base of that. And that sort of did it. So now I have basically the top of that column, at least spatially, looks like it's attached to the bottom of that. Okay, which is, you know, the way it actually be fabricated. It was doing something like that. Okay, you also have all sorts of relationships in here. Let me do this. Let me hide some floors. Where these look a little bit funny right now in terms of how they're connected. What happens is Revit by default uses a rule that says that, hey, I'm going to go through and draw the beam up to the point where the bounding box on the beam intersects the bounding box of anything that it might intersect with. Beyond that, I'm going to stop because, you know, I'm not quite sure how you're going to resolve that connection. So Revit stops with this. What you can do is cope things together. Okay, which is to sort of make them fit together a little more tightly and kind of come closer to approximating what this connection is. There actually are tools that people are working on to really do all the detailing of these connections based on all sorts of fabrication rules in great detail. So you might ask people in the room about that, because they would know how you could actually, in fact, maybe we could get someone to demonstrate something like that at some point. But it's we want to start connecting those things together. There's really a lot of intelligence that goes into how that happens that fabricators know about. You know, for our purposes, what we tend to do is, if it doesn't show and it's not visible, not to worry about it, because it's sort of a level of modeling detail that might just slow you down. But if you do want to care about it, what you do is you'll choose a beam and you'll choose, where is it? It's coping. And I always have to remember the order of this, because it's whether you cope that one into the other one or use the other one to cope that. I think coping is actually thought of as a cutting operation. So I'll choose that one, I'll say cope. Actually, in this case, it didn't, because what I need to do is go through and extend it a little bit. Let me try this. Okay, I basically extended the beam so it violated the other beam. Now I can say that I want to take this and cope it and choose that one. Oh, try it the other direction. Try that one and cope it with that one. Not quite. Why am I messing up? Put that back to half inch again. I gotta get them so they overlap, but at the same time go through and say that I want to do this. Is it to that one? Hey, Henry, what do you think? Coping was applied, but no cut was made. It's because it was extending too far. Yeah, go on.
No, I actually have no idea.
It's a funky tool. And again, we don't tend to use it very much just because it's sort of, you know, it's like a level of layering or modeling. Oh, there, that actually did it that time. And you see what happened there? It went ahead and cut the flange, or it cut the flanges back, so they're holding off a half inch, and it allowed the web to go in as though you were going to go through and like kind of put a bracket in there. So, yeah, interesting stuff. Okay, enough of that. So I think, you know, just in terms of openings and not so openings, kind of okay in terms of starting to think about some of that stuff. Let me go ahead. Let me change to Mr. Sengchai's like model and sort of see what we have going on in there. So, of your buildings, the one that's the most interesting, I think of the one that has the most kind of, you know, questions, is it the leaf building, or which building is the one that sort of is the most interesting to you?
Yeah, it's the leaf structure.
Okay, let's go ahead and open it. We'll kind of show it to people and we'll think about how we might approach that as a modeling problem. So we'll say, let us go out to the USB drive. Okay, and there he is. Let's see what we have here. Okay, so we have quite an interesting model, actually, at a high level. Look at it, it's actually developing very nicely. Okay, so as you think about this building, can you tell us a little about it overall? Like, you know, we have a main exhibition center over here. This looks like it's probably a fairly regular structure, although we have some columns supporting the overhangs out there at the outside, so as opposed to cantilevering them. We have a balcony over here that's probably gonna be cantilevered though. We'll think about that. Maybe it pops up to the third floor with a little skylight. That's actually quite a nice little kind of octagonal skylight. Did you make that out of slope glazing, or did you find that somewhere?
I found it in the Rapid
City. Oh, very nice. It's kind of that's kind of attractive. Another one to think about. Okay, we have the main exhibition building. We have kind of a shaft tower over here that might have an elevator or some stairs. And this is quite an interesting building over there. Okay, so as we think about the leaf building, go ahead and talk about sort of what you're trying to do with it in terms of the height, or you have quite an interesting roof. Look at that. That's quite interesting. So is that a series of different forms, like curvaceous forms that come from both sides, or?
Yeah, it's two sides. And then I purposely leave a gap in between the two leaves so that light can actually penetrate through the slings.
So right through here, there's like a little light shaft or something
yeah.
like that. Okay, wow. Okay, you give us an interesting challenge then in terms of thinking about this and how to do it. But okay, we'll work on this. As we think about, let's go to, is it level one? That's our leaf building over here. Okay, what I almost want to do, where I tend to typically approach this is, I start thinking about how to support the roof first, and then go from there. Now, is this building, is it one story or two stories, or what's actually?
Just one story.
So just one story and just sort of this very curvaceous roof above it.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, let's think about that. So if I looked up at the ceiling plan, okay, what's happening here? Is there a ceiling in there? Let me do this a little wireframe action.
So it's a glass roof right now, a flat glass roof.
Okay, in the center it's glass?
Yeah, attaching to the leaf light roof.
Okay, very good. And then these two things are more this curving concrete thing. Okay, very good. No worries. It's kind of tricky. As you think about drawing this building, or you think about trying to support the roof, like, you know, what is your sort of inclination relative to, you have these different forms. Do you think about columns being on the outside or being on the inside? Or where do you think about, you know, support for this? Because it's all glass walls on the outside.
I was actually thinking of putting all the columns inside the structure.
Very good. Okay, so we could, for example, put some columns just inside here, like at some distance along the edge. I think that's actually quite attractive to do something like that. Okay, then we'll do something like this over on the other side. So now I have the interesting question here of, like, how we support everything between these things. Okay, so as you think about this, because you have this funny curvaceous thing going on, there's a couple of ways we might approach that. We could go ahead and, you know, if it didn't have the hump in the middle, like where it came, if it was like sort of flat surfaces, I'd think about sloping beams, something like that. But since you actually have a curving surface, I might think instead about a truss sort of system, something where we can follow the curving profile. Okay, but make it out of smaller members that all sort of join together to follow that. Okay, so as you think about the structure, even though it's a very irregular structure, my inclination is to try to go through and like create some relatively straight line elements like this that go across that sort of follow that curving thing. But how are you thinking? Is it something like that, or what is your intuition telling you?
Yeah, it's pretty much like that. And then the other side of the grid lines would be parallel to the inner straight walls.
Oh, okay, so like these straight walls right here?
Yeah.
Very good. It's kind of an interesting thing to think about. Do you think that we could go through and span the entire distance with one truss, or do you think that we actually have to have some interior support? Like, what's the distance from the wide side over here to the wide side over there? Oh, very good. Hang on, let's take a look. We see, now it's about 60 feet there.
Oh, I thought you mean the other
way. Oh, the other way.
Yeah.
Oh, that's okay. That's very easy in terms of what's going on. In this direction, it's 60 feet. I'm just trying to think, do you think there are some intermediate like columns in the middle here, or do you think that, you know, there are not? Like, yeah, you know, is there a column somewhere in the middle? Or is it just like one truss that goes all the way to 60 feet across?
Maybe just one truss.
Okay, let's try that. Let us try that. Okay, so let's go through and do this. What I'm going to do is, just to get started, I'm not going to copy it into a separate file, because, you know, just for the purpose of speed, it would just take some more time. But let's think about how we could do this. If I came up with some nice grid lines, something like that. Okay, and I'll offset those about 16 feet or something like that. Some very regular system. Now let's think about trying to go through and create a grid line that does the other thing on the outside. And again, I think the way to do this might be to go ahead and approximate it with a series of arcs in this multi-segment thing. So if I do this, and I say over here, and this is always tricky because there's no sort of hard and fast, actually, let me do it so it's more on the line here. There's no hard and fast rule. It's just sort of whatever sort of approximates that shape as best you think you can, because it's a little bit organic in terms of the actual shape. I should move that. Come back over here. Okay. That'll be one of my grid lines. The other one will be kind of following the other direction. So we'll say architecture, do a grid here, again, sort of here, oh, maybe out to there. The grid lines, I think, are going to be useful to us because when it comes time to draw the trusses, we're going to need them, or I think they'll come in handy for us. Well, this is kind of an interesting one here because it almost has to sort of follow that and then it has to sort of double back. Not to worry. Although I'm offset a little, blah, 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 blah. Oh, it's interesting. I'm sort of drawing in a funny way. I shouldn't move in the middle of drawing. Okay, so now I have these two different grid lines. So super. We'll start by putting these columns in. And as you think about the columns, are these concrete or are they steel or what do you sort of think they are? Okay, steel? Okay, great. We'll say the height will change a little bit, although we're going to have to do that on the individual lines. We'll see if I can figure it out. And we'll say, how about, well, actually, that could happen in the truss, too. Let's put some columns in. At the grid intersections, and let's do it at the intersections. Boom. I'm just going to let them be square to the grid right now with the idea that, you know, I'm going to cover them over a little bit later with some sort of material that'll kind of make them look round. Although I could go through. I should take that back. I could do that too. X, erase all this. So you see I do have all these in here. If I want to go through now and rotate that, that's just fine actually. I could go through and, you know, try to make it more planar or whatever it is that I have in mind to go through and do that. Actually, over here, that one is pretty planar. You. Kind of following all the surface normals. Actually, I'll make a comment just because some folks are in C. You could imagine there'd be some fantastic tool that would go through and align your columns so they're always lining up with the surface normals or something like that. Because again, if that's an artistic effect you want, you know, it's easy to go ahead and apply a little automation to do something like that. Okay, super. So I got some columns in there. Oh, I didn't even think about what height they are. Let's start with, like, how high is that roof? Does it go to level 2 or level 1? Or, like, what height does it go to? Sort of at the base, and then we'll go from there.
From level 1 to level 2.
Okay.
Which is around 15 feet.
Very good. Okay, so let's say structural columns. Okay, they go up to level 1, level 2 right now. Super. What I want to think about doing is actually going through and having a truss that will go through and have that shape. And trusses are a little bit funny in terms of how they work, because they can resize themselves or reshape themselves pretty nicely. Let me think if I can come up with something that'll illustrate this. If I go back to like level 2, I'll place it at level 2, you can use something called the truss tool. The truss tool is just really a whole series of different truss elements. I can load one in here right now. Structural trusses. Trusses are really known by just the shape. So there's these different Fink trusses, Howe trusses, and there's different trusses that all have kind of different shapes and different arrangements of the top and bottom cord. So part of this is just sort of finding one that approximates the shape that you want it to have, whether it's, you know, two segments or one segment, something like that. But, you know, for example, that might be one that is a shape that approximates what we want to have happen. In this case, that shape that I'm using right now has two different top chords, which I think may be useful to us just in terms of being able to sort of adapt the truss to sort of fit the shape that we have. So let me try that one. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to go through and place that truss at level 2. Oh, I have to put some columns on the other side too, just to sort of make it possible. Little column at the grids. Come on over here. I'll say you. Didn't I get them? I swear I got them. Okay, that'll be fine. Finish up. Okay, so I'm going to go through and put a truss in there. I'll say structural. Use my funny truss here. I'm going to go from here over there. And I'm also going to go here over to here. Now, this is not going to be quite right, but let's going to take a look at what it did and go from there. Okay, here is the truss. You can sort of see the truss. It's kind of hanging around over there. It has a certain number of, let me even kind of make your roof sort of transparent or something like that. Override graphics in view, this element. Okay, so you can sort of see that little guy in there. What we would really like to have happen is that this truss would actually go ahead and conform itself to the shape of the roof. Okay, and it's a little bit tricky, but you can get it to do that. If this roof were not a mass roof, I think we would just be able to say attach it directly to the roof, and that would actually sort of work. So if you have, I'm going to take that. It might work for a mass roof. Let's just try it. Come on over here. Let me say attach the top or bottom. Is it going to let me do it? I don't think it's going to let me do it just because this is sort of an unusual shape. That's because it's a mass roof. Masses are always a little bit strange in terms of what's going on. Not to panic, though. We'll be able to sort of fix it. What we can do is, let's go back in, and because you have such an unusual form, I think what we're going to have to do is this. Basically, what I want is a view that will show the cut through the roof where that truss is going to happen. So what I'm going to do is go back to the level. And what I'm going to do is actually just give myself a view, which is a section view, kind of right on grid 2. Or parallel to grid 2. Let's take a look at that view. So here we see there's the truss. There's the truss elements in terms of what's going on. Now, a couple things about the truss that are sort of a little bit gronky in terms of what's going on. One is the truss elements are quite large right now, and it's only because it only knows how to use the elements that are loaded into the software. So if you want to have a finer truss, one that has finer cords and things like that, what you have to do is just insert some structural elements that are known to be a little smaller. So for example, I can say for structural framing, let's go through for some steel, maybe a little hollow tube steel. We'll do that section. I'll do not these 20 by 20s, I'll go for relatively small things, like 4x4s or something like that. But now what I can do is take the truss and just basically edit its type. You'll see that it has these properties for what the top framing should be, and we can make it a smaller element, what the diagonal web should be, what the bottom chord should be. And again, these could all be different. I'm just going to make them for simplicity the same thing right now and say okay. Okay, it's a little bit skinnier now, so that could be okay. After we have that little bit skinnier, we can say great, even in terms of here, there's usually this issue of the truss height there, the truss width. There's usually an issue of like being able to change how many chords are in there. Maybe not in this one. Okay. Let me go ahead and edit the truss profile though, because trusses have profiles too. Okay. This is the top chord. That's the bottom chord right there. If you'd like to sort of form the truss so it sort of conforms to more what's going on here, let's see if I can pick that surface. It doesn't look like, again, it's because it's an irregular shape, I'm going to be able to do that. But let me see if I can approximate it. I'll go from here, sort of to here. Then I will continue from here. This is going to use kind of the pink line rules. And then even here, I'll go down to here. That's a pretty bad approximation there. Let's try this again. I'll say from here, really kind of more to here. I should say chain. Chain will actually kind of make them stick together. And now to here. I'll try to follow that curve. Again, not exactly precise, but it'll be close. If I have that as my top chord, let's see about this. I'm not 100% certain what's going to happen because I have this two segments, but we'll see. So I may have to do this out of two different trusses. Well, let's just try to see if I can get this to work. The truss top and bottom references can't cross. I think that probably has to do with right in here. Again, a little imprecise. A serious, oh, not bad again. This is really kind of bugging us in terms of what it needs to do in terms of that, because it's, you know, we'll have to go back and recreate that. I didn't save this at all. Yeah, but we're basically playing a game where we're trying to get the truss to conform to a curve. Okay, and it really is a game of just the upper and lower parts of the curve, yeah, and making that happen. It's a, you typically, if it weren't for this mass surface just gives us so much trouble because it's really hard to attach to it in terms of what's going on. Because if you can get it to attach and you don't have to draw it, that actually works out better. But let's kind of see what we can do in terms of trying to give you something that'll be helpful. Yeah, it didn't completely crash. Let me try this. I think it may be complaining just because of that. And it means we might have to come up with another strategy in terms of the two-sided. But let me go for something that's a little bit simpler. I'll just take this here. I'll copy that one so that we're really under one half of your curve, not under both halves. Okay, say structure. let's put a truss in there. I'm going to put in, I'm going to load in a slightly different truss, one that just has a single top cord. Was it a 3? It's a 2. Okay, got it. I'm at level 1, which of course is not a very good level. But in general, the principle is you should be able to say attach and attach, but again, it's because it's that funny shape, I don't think we're able to get that. So let me try editing the profile again and see if I can come up with something that will stick. Chain it. Too many top lines. Okay, so you start getting things that look like that. Now, this is all based on kind of coming flat across the bottom. This would kind of work. We could come up with something more where we want it to go, so the base goes here, but it, you know, comes up to some intermediate point. I want to think about, even on this curve here right now, it's all this flat glass right in here, whether there's a way that we could maybe intersect a little bit higher up, you know, kind of up in here, so that that glass plane sort of slopes down towards the pool at the end. But then we would try to basically get a series of trusses that look, you know, from here to here coming down in a column, but then have that same sort of issue where they come up and, you know, do whatever they're doing. Okay, so it's not a great solution yet. We still have some more work in terms of how to come up with that unusual surface, the best way to do it. But it's probably going to be something like that, where we go through, and because it's such an unusual shape, we just have to go through and adjust the profile of each of the different trusses, because they're a little bit unique in each of those different cases. Okay, I'll keep playing around with the whole issue of the surface though, because I know I've done some things with surfaces where you can just get it attached directly to it. So I've got to figure out what the difference is between the surfaces that I've been creating and the surface you've created about why it won't do the attach. Because everything about this is just really difficult just because of that, you know, it's got so much curvature, it has a very hard time attaching anything to it. Okay, so that's a start. But let's go ahead and let's see if any other questions floating around. We're just about done for today, but it's really all about this whole issue of, you know, different ways of thinking of supporting the structure. Yeah, and I was thinking about that I kind of wanted to reinforce about your project too, that's kind of cool, is, oh, even in a case like this, let's say we did have a column coming on down. If you wanted to have, I'll put a column over here too on the other side of the hallway. Okay. If we wanted to think about having a floor that was more like an intermediate floor halfway up so that you could have like a balcony up in here or something like that, you know, that's kind of okay too. We can go through and do a floor like this and almost have it just cantilevered off both sides of that central hallway so that there's a railing over here and there's a railing over here. Okay, and that's kind of a nice feature sometimes, because then what happens is, you know, when people are standing up in here and they're at the balcony railing and they're looking over, okay, they don't really see a lot of structural support. It sort of feels like that floor is floating above the entire space. It's because I think part of what's nice about your space is there's this feeling that at some level, you know, inside this glass, there's sort of a big open volume there. And that's sort of part of what you're trying to do, is have that feeling of, you know, you're just behind a giant glass surface. So, I don't know, we'll keep on playing with that. Okay, so some more focused work on your specific project, just because that's a very tough structure. But I think the main structure is easier. This one's going to take a lot of tender loving care to kind of really kind of get things to the structural layout in here. Okay, let's think. Gustavo, you feel pretty good about your structure?
I think so. It's fairly standard.
yeah, pretty rectangular in terms of what's going on. A little bit of fuzziness around the openings, but you'll start to figure out what the relationship is there. Dr. Harmanji, how about for you?
Yeah, I'm also wondering about the box.
So. Okay, so fairly regular. No worries. You can think about interesting ways to put a circular opening in somewhere. You know, a lot of times a little bit of curvature goes a long way to really sort of making a point. Yeah, so
I put in a square opening.
It's a design decision. Your design style. You're going hard, geometric, and very hard edge. Okay. So, yeah.
So at the footings, do we do 2 feet below ground?
Interesting. Yeah. It really depends on the specific soil condition. It's a good question. Yeah, as we think about like all these columns, let's see if they even have any in here still. Once you crash, you're never quite sure. So I got these columns floating around in here. Yeah, again, the general rule is that if we're gonna think about this as really sort of being bearing, put a little isolated footing in there. What do I got in here? Structural footings, isolated. Okay, we'll put it up the columns. So, big rules are the length and the width, okay, really just depends on how many square feet you need to spread it over. And if you don't have any other information, think about 2,000 pounds per square foot. And so the number of square feet will be the number of pounds divided by that. Okay, so we'll do that. In terms of how deep it is, here's kind of the interesting thing. If it's going to be shallow, as in it's just going to hang out here at the surface, then you generally want to go at least 2 feet deep. Okay, 2 feet is, it's kind of a general building code requirement for the base of the footing. It's considered, after you get below 2 feet deep, even if there's a frost or something like that, the soil below that probably isn't going to expand or heave or somehow change. So I think it's like 2 feet below undisturbed soil. So if you've scraped your whole side and filled it all back in, okay, it won't be 2 feet from the surface, it'll be 2 feet from like the bottom of whatever is considered to be undisturbed at that point. Okay, and that's for a shallow foundation. And it really just has to do with heaving. If like water or frost or something like that is gonna move the soil, you don't want that foundation to move, so you wanna get it deep enough so it's considered, stable. The other thing though to consider though, what we tend to do more often than this will be like for a slab foundation in a kind of a typical, actually your site might just very well be that. And a lot of hillsides and stuff like that, we'll do it a little bit differently. We'll go through and say, let's go through and get some structural foundations, and we'll do one of these pile caps that actually has some piles underneath it. Let's talk about that. I'll change that to look like this. Piles do this. They say, great, I'm spreading that load through that piece of concrete up there. It's really like a really short beam, but I'm going to do one of two things, either through the bearing capacity at the bottom of those long kind of essentially concrete columns. I'm going to carry all that load down to bedrock and bear on it. So I get not the 2,000 pounds per square foot, I get some really sturdy rock that's going to resist it. So you either think of that as being bearing, at which point we have to basically treat those as like columns, concrete columns, and just kind of spread the load, make sure there's enough of them to kind of like transfer the load down. The other way you sometimes do it though is if you don't have a lot of bedrock, is we'll treat these as friction piles. And friction piles are set up like this. If you think about the total surface area, so not really the bearing, but the surface area, and you think about that as a straw that's going down into some really squishy, gushy mud, okay, what happens is eventually just the suction or the friction around it will stop it and support it. And that's actually what we do with an awful lot of buildings. We put enough of those in there that just the friction around that is enough to actually hold it and make it be considered safe. So if you're looking at something like this, and instead of four, it has like 15 piles in it or something like that, chances are you're a friction pile system in a wet environment, like that. But so long-winded answer to your short question, which is 2 feet below undisturbed.
Okay.
But if you need a deeper foundation, we'll play down games like this. Beautiful. Okay, let us pause there for today. Hopefully it's kind of helpful to look at your buildings and think about some specifics. But as you get ready to kind of meet with us next, go through and just be thinking about like some specific questions and challenges you're having. We'll do some thinking about your unusual roof. So let me think about it a little, see if I come up with a better strategy for you. Because it's really, yeah, you could spend all night easily just trying to solve that problem, but that may not be the best use of your time. Okay, so we'll see if we can come up with a more creative way to do that. Okay? Beauty. Okay, let us adjourn for today then.